Today on the Certified Q&A, let's tackle another question for the Google Cloud Platform Associate Cloud Engineer. It's very important to the process of understanding Google Cloud and passing the certification exam that you go through the question and attempt answering it yourself first. So pause the video, work through the question. We'll catch up in just a little while and I'll show you how I do it. In this project scenario, you want to create a new role for your colleagues that will apply to all current and future projects created in your organization. The role should have permissions of the BigQuery job user and Cloud Bigtable user roles. You want to follow Google's recommended practices. How should you create the new role? The key parts of the question are, of course, that we need to create a new role. That's part of the requirement. It has to apply to current projects and any new projects in the organization. And it should combine the permissions of a couple of existing roles. Now, this is fairly common to have done because you want to have a role specific to your organization that is not currently served by any of the existing roles provided by Google Cloud. In approaching this, let's look at what our options are. Essentially, we are dealing with what is called identity and access management. IAM says or defines who can do what on which resource. The who part of this, the identity or the member, has five possibilities. If you have your own personal account and you signed up for Google Cloud Platform, you will have your Google Cloud Platform account with that email ID. So it would be at, say, abcd@gmail.com. Another option is to take the G Suite set of products in which you can have a custom domain. So if you have your company, you can have email addresses at thatcompany.com. When you use G Suite, you also get all the office tools for that, like the slides, the sheets, the docs, hangouts, all the others. For companies that probably already have an existing office tool, an office suite, but still wants to adopt Google Cloud, they can use Cloud Identity. You still then get an email address at yourcompany.com, but then you do not get access to the office tools like slides and sheets and docs. A group of members can be put together in a Google group, and you can choose how to name it and which members to add. All of these four require somebody to log in. There is an actor, human actor involved in the first four types of accounts. But this is not the only situation. There are times when machines have to talk to each other. Say, for example, you want to set up a cron job to do a backup every day at 2 or 3 in the morning. You can't have somebody putting an alarm, waking up at that time, and then running this cron job. You want it to happen automatically. So when there are apps or machines that need to talk to each other, then you use the fifth option, which is a service account. The next part of this is, what can they do, right? And this is defined in permissions. So each of the resources within Google Cloud have a set of permissions attached to it. For example, you can create disks, you can delete disks, you can list or view disks. Similarly for images, you can list them, you can create them, you can delete them. Depending on the resource, there could be different actions that you can perform. Each such action that you can perform is given as a permission. However, there are a large number of permissions that are there, considering that there are a large number of resources and each of them have different actions you can perform on them. This is a huge list. If you had to individually assign and manage these permissions for every actor or identity and attach it to a resource, that becomes too cumbersome. So an easier way to handle this is to group these permissions into roles. So for example, a service account creator in this case has the ability to create a service account, get the service accounts, list the whole all the service accounts. And of course, where you apply the service account, you need to do that for a project. So you should also have the permissions related to listing a project or getting a particular project. And it is these roles then that we can assign to members. The process of assigning these roles to members comes together in what is called a policy. So a policy connects the members to the roles and says what each of these members can do, because the role then defines the permissions that are allowed on resources. In the roles itself, there are three types of roles: primitive, predefined, and custom roles. Primitive roles are very wide set of roles, and they have a wide set of permissions, and there are three of them: viewer, editor, and owner, and on a separate side, there is a billing administrator. The viewer on all resources has the ability to list and get the resource, but they can't do anything more than that. An editor has all the permissions of the viewer, which of course read and view the resource, but can additionally modify the resource. They can deploy applications, modify code, and configure services. An owner has all the permissions of the editor and the viewer, and additional permissions to remove users, add users, and delete projects. So these are permissions with very wide scope. Because those have very wide scope, because primitive roles are very wide scope, sometimes, or in most cases, that is not the preferred approach. You want to give more granular permissions specific to what is required to get the job done based on the principle of least privilege. Do not give more permissions than is required to get the job done. Obviously, you can't give lesser, because then the job cannot get done. So predefined roles would be like this set, which says that, say, a service account deleter has a specific set of permissions as a part of it. Note how the service account deleter has the ability to delete a service account, which is not there for a service account creator. So these are way more granular than the primitive roles. When neither the primitive nor the predefined roles suit a business requirement for your organization, then you can create a custom role. Custom roles typically are created based on existing roles. You will take a few existing roles and combine them while modifying some roles or permissions that you either want to add or you want to remove. It is important to note that custom roles are not maintained by Google, which means that when new features or services are added to Google Cloud, these custom roles will not get automatically updated. So the onus is on you to ensure that it suits whatever is the current feature set within Google Cloud. As a best practice, before creating a custom role, see if there is a predefined role or a combination of these predefined or primitive roles that suit your use case, and you shouldn't be creating copies of existing roles. As always, name it well, right? Choose unambiguous titles for custom roles so that any person coming into the organization later has a clear indication of what this role is expected to do. Having understood all those now, let us look at the first option, which suggests that we do GCloud IAM combined roles and apply globally to combine the two roles in a new custom role. Could this work? Probably. What do we want to do? We want to combine two roles, the BigQuery job user and the Bigtable user. And this command, if it existed, would combine them. That kind of makes sense. But is there a better option? Now, first thing is here that we've got two roles, role A and role B, in this case, the BigQuery user and the Bigtable user, they already exist. So why don't we just assign both roles? What do we gain by just combining a couple of existing roles? So in a real project scenario, I would have vetoed the suggestion, because we do not want to necessarily create repetitions of the same set of roles. I would rather just assign role A and role B, and now universally we know what that means. Irrespective of which project, which organization we are in, we know exactly what these means because these are predefined roles across Google Cloud. However, in this case, the requirement necessitates that you do this, right? Ideally, what you would have done is you combine these two roles, but then you remove some roles or edit some permissions, which makes it customized for your organization. But maybe for simplicity, they've made this question a little smaller and they've just required you to combine the two roles. So even if it is not an ideal best practice, let's go with the requirement that we just have to combine the two roles. So if this option was available as a subcommand, it might be reasonable to assume that we can do this. However, the fact is that such a subcommand does not exist. There is no command that goes gcloud IAM combined roles. So this option is not possible and therefore we can eliminate it. What about the next option, which suggests for one of your projects in the Google Cloud Platform console under roles, select both roles and combine them into a new custom role. Then use gcloud IAM promote role to promote the role from a project role to an organization role. Again, if there was such an option, then maybe it would work. But the whole thing does not pass the smell test. It's very odd to find a subcommand called promote role. Where is it promoting it? It's promoting it up the hierarchy. That's not usually something that is done. And why promote role? Even if there was such a thing, why wouldn't you rather just copy the role? Or why don't you move the role? And why would you start at the project level and then try to push it up? Why don't you start at the organization level itself? So for multiple reasons, this does not seem a reasonable approach. If you look at the command itself, you can find that this does not exist. It obviously does not make sense, just intuitively doesn't feel right, and the command anyway doesn't exist, so this is yet another option that we can eliminate. Now let's look at option C, which suggests that for all projects in the Google Cloud Platform console under roles, select both roles and combine them into a new custom role. What could be the problem with this approach? The issue is that if you're going to select all the projects right now, those will be what are current. But our requirement necessitates that it also has to apply to future projects. So what do we have to do when there is a new project? Do we have to go back here, again select that new project and then apply this again? That doesn't make sense at all. So this already has a loophole, and I'm not convinced that this is going to be a good option at all. Even so, let us go find out in the console if it is possible to do this at all. We are right now at the roles for the organization, and when we click on roles, it does not show any projects. It only shows the roles that are available at the organization level and none of the projects, which is to be expected. Given a resource hierarchy that goes from organization, potentially folders, then the projects, and then the resources, if we did anything at the organization level, say like filtering for roles, it does not necessarily mean that it's going to pick up everything under it. Because in this case, for example, if you're filtering by roles, it is not going to show you the roles for all the hundreds of projects or thousands of resources under it. Similarly, we cannot have, or it's not logical to expect that applying this particular role at the organization level already moves it all the way down, right? We won't be able to see all the projects at the organization level when we filter for roles at the organization level. So one, it does not work for all future projects. And anyway, this is not possible via the console. You just do not have a way to select all the projects under roles in the console. What about the last option? That for your organization, in the Google Cloud Platform console under roles, select both roles and combine them into a new custom role. Let us see if this is possible. So here I am at the organization roles. In step one, I select the two roles that I want to combine. Now that I have that, I can click the button create role from selection, which gives me a page where I can name my new role and also gives me the set of permissions that are automatically inherited from both these roles. In an ideal situation, I would have not gone for all these permissions. I would have edited them to suit whatever is the requirement for my business. But in this particular case, the question requires that we do just as much, and therefore we are okay with this option. Given that, we can eliminate all the others and choose D as the correct option for this question. What are the key learnings we can take away? IAM is fundamental to any task on the cloud. You need to know it well. You need to understand what are resources, roles, permissions, and policies. You also have to understand the hierarchy of organization, folder, project, and resource. How do they inherit permissions from each other? What happens to a permission that you set at the organization level? Can you revoke them at the project level or resource level? The answer is you cannot. You also have to learn how to set these roles via the console and using the command line gcloud. For these, the quick labs are very useful. Know the different kinds of roles: primitive, predefined, and when those do not suit, then a custom role. Know how you can create custom roles, typically by starting off from existing roles and modifying them as required. Also know what are the best practices for any product or solution, including the one for custom roles. I will leave you with a bunch of references around IAM, around the best practices on IAM, especially when working with large enterprise organizations, and guides that teach you how to set the service account, IAM, and access control for all kinds of resources. If you're interested in picking up loads more learning on Google Cloud, go ahead and subscribe right away.